That's good. Let's concentrate now. You know, when you're in a room full of managers, it's difficult to make them quiet down. Right, we want to recognize Engineer Mlilo, the PEMSEC in the Ministry of Local Government, Public Works, and National Housing. He is with us now. Thank you for joining us, Engineer Mlilo. I am going to hand over to Dr. Fumbare. The way we are going to proceed is we are going to help. Thank you very much. I can actually cause to happen that the network over here can be shut down so that there isn't any GSM network. It is within my powers to be able to do that. Please let me not do that. I'm handing over to Dr. Tumbare and then we can proceed from there. Thank you.
Thank you all. I'd like to introduce our next presenter. This is Dr. Chabuluka. He's going to talk on urban settlement planning and making in a changing environment. After his presentation, we'll then pose questions to both himself and Professor Makaza, who presented just before tea. Dr. Chabuluka, please. Thank you.
Thank you, Session Chair. I would like to recognize the Director of our Ceremonies, Dr. Abanyegwi, the Vice Chancellor in his absentia, excellencies from other universities, executives from all the urban councils, and fellow academics. I'm going to proceed by giving a background. I will then look at issues in urban settlement planning, followed by the best practice in urban settlement planning. I will then shift to look at issues in mapping, and again look at the best practice in relating to those emerging issues, and I will conclude with the way forward.
Shift to more practical issues.
The main issue that we are facing as a country, and an issue that is also facing other developing countries, is that because of rapid federalization that is taking place right now, there are rising levels of poverty in urban settlements, and also increasing informality or informal businesses and informal settlements in urban areas. This urbanization is taking place at such a rapid rate that in academic circles we are actually now talking about the urbanization of poverty. And that urbanization of poverty is coupled with the changing nature of our urban settlements. Our settlements are changing in the sense that there are a lot of local dynamics that are taking place as a result of the influx of our people into urban areas, and also as a result of the impact of globalization on our settlements. And internally in settlements, there are a lot of dynamics, as we can notice that land use is now changing. I can give the example, for example, now we use the planning to separate the place of work from the place of living. But increasingly now, the development that is taking place automatically is that people are combining the place of residence and the employment. And planning is still to catch up with those changes that are taking place in practice. Conventional settlement planning, which is the planning that we are doing today, which is a modernist planning, was actually developed and designed to manage a formal setup. That is, the planning approaches that we are using were developed to manage a setup where we actually assume an industrial society. A society where there are formal businesses, formal jobs, etc., etc. But the reality is that the world we are living in the developing world has changed. It has changed dramatically in the manner in which I earlier described. And because of the increase in the number, in the proportion of the poor within the urban population, now internationally, as far as planning is concerned, there is now a drive towards the development of inclusive cities. The assumption is that our cities are developing and marginalizing the poor people. But when we think about the sustainable development goals and the work that UN Habitat is doing, we realize that already that calls for change in the sense that our cities need to be inclusive. I'll run through some of the urban settlement planning issues. One of the problems that we face in urban settlement planning is that there are cumbersome land development processes. The land development process, all the way from land acquisition to the preparation of master plans, local plans, to the preparation of layouts, survey, and then the granting of planning permission for development is so long that in some ways it is also contributing to many of the problems that we are facing with illegal development in our cities. Coupled with that is that right now we are working with the outdated spatial development frameworks. I'm referring there to outdated master plans and local plans and town planning schemes. If I take the example of Harare, combination master plan, as far as I remember, was prepared in the early 90s. That was a totally different era when we were just at the beginning of our ESA. Now in 2017, after our fast track in 2000, the whole dynamic of our urban development is changed. So much so that the master plans that we have, which were prepared in the 1990s, cannot cope or deal with the issues that are taking place in urban areas now. So there's been rapid urban spatial transformation in all our urban areas, which were not anticipated by many of the master plans, the local plans that we prepared. Related to that is the problem that the local and layout plans that we get in our urban areas are fragmented. We have, for example, we have a layout plan in one area, a layout plan in another area, but in many cases, we have not combined all those plans into one plan. And when it comes to coordinating development in urban areas, that causes a lot of challenges. Also, when it comes to dealing with issues of development control, because our plans are so fragmented, it's difficult also to control development. An earlier presenter talked about the need for models, the need for a vision of the future of the city. I think Professor Peter was talking about a model, a vision about the future economy of the city. And one of the participants was talking about the need for the model of the future form of the city. That's another area where we have problems. Most of our plans are two-dimensional. And when we present them to developers, developers really sometimes do not get an idea of what we as local authorities anticipate as the future development. But if our plans built into them some models about what the future should look like, say in 100 years to come or 50 years to come, then that would help all developers in envisaging the kind of development that the Urban Council is looking towards to, and the kind of investment that the Urban Council is thinking about, and that would at the same time help in reducing illegal developments or substandard developments in our cities. I remember the former town clerk of Gweru asking me to say I was not working in the council, but he was asking me why we as planners were allowing substandard structures in Gweru city centers. Part of the answer would be that as planners, or as Urban Council, we are planners, part of the answer would be that we do not have a model for the future Gweru city center. We do not have. So somebody comes, an investor comes, and they put up a building which looks like the same they would put at Mataka Gold Coast in Iperego, which is a lower order settlement. And when we come to a higher order settlement like a city, we expect to have something that is more aesthetic and more attractive to investors. The level of specialization in areas of comparative advantage He has already been belabored by Professor Wiken. So I will not dwell on that. He talked a lot about competitiveness and competitive advantage, but what I'm only saying there is that our planning should incorporate all those issues. Urban councils should not be jacks of all trades. They should identify their areas of competitive advantage and build their competitiveness on the basis of that. And there has been underinvestment in the planning function in urban councils. At least those are urban councils that I have visited, a number of them. It is not stable that there has been underinvestment in the planning function, in the sense of the resources that are made available for planning in terms of equipment. Equipment that is required for planning and other resources. Or in many cases, in terms of the role that the planning function is expected to play in the urban council. It's demoralizing sometimes when I walk into urban councils and I find people coming around, all they are concerned with is they want to check, is this stand surveyed, is this stand vacant, and so forth and so forth. But there is no investment in long-term planning. Rather, what I see is more of crisis management and attending to the problems of today. When the day is done, tomorrow planners are being called upon sometimes by councillors or other leaders within the council to do small pieces of work which should be done by technicians or students who are there. But they get hidebound in those issues of regularization, formalization. Regularization does not solve our urban development problems. We need to be more strategic in planning. And that is what we as urban councils should prepare our planning. Sorry, I'm getting carried away. Best practice in our urban settlement planning. There has been a concern in the literature that master plans are static and rigid because, you know, they are like in the Harare Communication Master Plan, which I was talking about. They are slow in responding to the needs of developers. And other countries in the Western world, in South Africa as well, they have adopted more flexible spatial development frameworks, which provide for broader policies and which allow the planning system to be more responsive to the needs of developers. Then there is best practice in settlement planning now also involves a lot of use of technology in planning, that is use of geographical information systems, computer-aided design, urban design and development control, and also use of three-dimensional models in visualizing future urban form and development. So in other developing countries, it's now a requirement for a local plan, for example, or a layout plan, not only to present the plan in three-dimensional, in two-dimensional form for approval, but it should also be accompanied by a vision, by the three-dimensional model, so that it shows the impression of the future urban form. There is integration of urban and transportation planning to cater for affordable mobility. Most of our planning now is just an extension layout of residential areas. And because there are so many extensions of residential areas, planning has lost all sight of integrating circulation, that is mass circulation, into the planning framework. Best practice also now requires use of sustainability targets and indicators to create sustainable settlements and the adoption of resilience measures in the urban ecosystem. On many issues, I will be very quick because I think they are quite compact. We do not have many units in most urban councils, and we do not have up-to-date maps and photographs and images for us to use in settlement planning. Where we have best mapping for planning, the best mapping is very fragmented, like I earlier pointed on, and sometimes it's difficult to snap those pieces of best maps. And then, where planners have tried to convert manual maps to digital maps, which are computerized maps, they face the problems of availability of resources within the urban council. Best practice in mapping for settlement planning now requires, for example, urban councils to feed into the cadastre, which forms the basis of our settlement planning. That means every urban area has got a cadastre map, which is produced by the surveyor general. And the urban councils need to be updating that map on a continuous basis after every 10 to 7. And global trends now into migrate from analog towards to digital data. The advantage of that is that it allows manipulation of the maps in a GIS, in of land parcels and carrying monitoring of development. The trend has also been towards the use of remote sensing data and satellite imagery for as a metric base in urban design. And the trend has also been towards capturing of data in a GIS format. Those diagrams they show the analog, which is the hard copy map. Now, the trend is now to move, convert that map, to digitize it into a digital map, which when now in the computer environment, it's easier to manipulate. Like if we are looking at 2016, it's easier to query, for example, the state size, the owner of the state, whether it is title survey, development conditions, etc., because it is linked to a database. And that map there just shows a base now which uses a map base, which now uses satellite images rather than using a Cold War base map. The way forward with urban settlement planning and mapping. We are saying that urban councils now need transformation of planning framework and practices. I was talking about ambitious master plans. Now we need to incorporate the more flexible spatial development frameworks concepts into the master and global planning process. We need more flexible planning frameworks and adoption of new planning approaches. For example, going for vertical development and inclusive urban design. System development based on our transition from analog to digital urban planning. And the initial exercise would begin with joining fragmented maps and digitizing the analog maps that we already have in our council. We need to plan and to protect.
Okay. You can summarize.
Okay, so just to conclude, I'll say the message I'm putting across is that as universities, we are available to work with urban councils in the area of modernizing the planning system, particularly the long-term planning framework and urban design and development control. And we are also available to work with urban council on system design. And in the end, I was just showing the cabinet of South Sudan who are looking at a model, part of the planning model of their future capital city, is Ramshek, which is the kind of planning that we are talking about, that planning should be, needs to be visualized. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Chabanuka, for your presentation. Sorry to speak you up, but we now open the session for clarifications, questions that we might hear for both Dr. Chabanuka and Professor Magadu. If you could please take a seat in front. Any questions? Prof. Magadu talked about wetlands and their importance and why we should try and preserve them. You recall before we went for tea. Any comments and clarifications for the evening? No. We're running with the mic.
Touch on climate change and
civilization types and agriculture. Professor Magaza has clearly demonstrated to us that climate change is impacting on hydrology of wetlands, and showed us for various deeps as well as land and wetlands which have been put under agriculture. My first question related to this one, to this area, concerns the role of wetlands as carbon sink. We are aware, of course, that elevated concentrations of carbon dioxide, methane, and other greenhouse gases in the atmosphere are motivating shifts in climate. I would like to call the professor to share his wisdom with us on that question. The last question, also related to climate change, is covering the area where wetlands have been put under agriculture. He showed us a clip of a wetland under vegetable production. It has been alleged, of course, Professor, that fertilizer practices under agriculture in wetlands are driving or motivating emissions of greenhouse gases which are causing global warming and hence climate change. I would like to call the professor to share his wisdom on these two aspects.
I think that we have an example of that.
Vertical development for residential places and as well as coming up with appropriate urban transportation that needs to be used. Because sprawling is not the best for us. We are not coping with sprawling. I think we should now start. The president did make a remark. He castigated my ministry very much when he was in Maroni. And we were giving land to the youth all over the country. And they say he doesn't want to see that. He wants us to go up. And we have since changed our stance and we are going up in areas. And I'm doing housing for the civil servants. And what I looked at was we have got abundant land in the cities, in every urban center. We've got land, for instance, where we used to have the messengers' camps. They've got a couple of houses there with people who have retired and they've got no income. And we are now putting up high rises on those areas. I hear you say, when you are saying the development process, I mean approval process is taking too long. I think government has come up with the ease of doing business. Hopefully, you are aware of that process or reform that is taking place. That for every local authority, it must guide the developers on the route to take to minimize waiting and going back and forth in the applying and approval process. So I don't know, but one day you correctly may say it, we are developing cities for the poor. That is not correct. Because all these people we are developing cities for haven't got any employment and there's not no prospects of better employment for them. These are going to continue to be poor. According to statistics and projections, by 2030, Zimbabwe will be having over 49% of people having migrated to urban centers. And we cannot continue to sprawl. And we need to go and think differently. I think our planning must be in sync with the kind of challenges that we have, especially where we have got challenges of infrastructure, roads, for instance, water, and sewage. We need to think. I thought the university was better ground to explore those areas and come up with better models than going to Virgin Land, coming out in layout plan and surveys. These areas are already planned. I think those are low-hanging fruits according to me. The university should be explored and harvest those. I thank you very much.
I think let's give an opportunity for our presenters to answer those questions.
What is already there And then, depending on the teams that may be working on that, to actually develop or transform the systems from the analog to the digital, to introduce GIS in those local authorities that may not be having the infrastructure, including related government departments, because these are same plans end up in government departments for approval. And if we do not address the system in its totality, then we'll leave some bottlenecks somewhere. Then there was a comment concerning the uptake of land surveyors in urban councils. I think this one is the urban councils that have to respond to this one, because when I used to work in local government some decades ago, we only had four registered land surveyors in the country, in the whole country, the whole of Zimbabwe. And at that time, because of the serious shortage of surveyors, urban councils were not hiring land surveyors. But I'm aware now that our universities have been training land surveyors, and by now we should be able, a lot of qualified land surveyors to be able to be supporting some of these systems or developments. But as to why urban councils have been slow in engaging with the land surveyors, I think we can get the feedback from the urban councils. And then concerning Honorable Mlilo's comments on urban settlements, vertical development, and the need to integrate issues of mass transport, etc., etc. Yes, that is one of the areas that we have identified in the presentation. I'm sorry if later on I just rushed through some of the slides, but that is one of the issues that we identified, the need for vertical development now, and for integration of mass transport, for the very reason of a lot of problems that we are encountering in urban areas because of urban sprawl and because of inefficiency in the transport circulation system. So we are in agreement that that is one area where universities, the relevant teams that will be working on infrastructure development, that's one area, potential area for collaboration with urban local authority. I'm aware of the ease of doing business approach that has been introduced by local authorities. But correct me if I am wrong, I'm aware of the documents, but I've not seen how this has actually been translated into practice. Because the remarks that we make from a technical point of view are based on the amount of time that is taken in land acquisition, the amount of time that is taken in processing an application for development. And we have not seen these time schedules becoming shorter. That's why I still raised the concept. So yes, I accept we have the ease of doing business documents, but to what extent if we transform that into good practice?
Thank you. I think I should point out two things that probably we've been skirting around, that may give an explanation both to my colleague's presentations and mine. This issue of communal lands. and other land uses. Communal lands were imported into this country from South Africa. They were designed by Cecil Rhodes when he became Prime Minister of the Cape Province. And I think his opening speech was, "These are my policies, and these would be the policies of South Africa. Number one, all natives will live in native reserves. There will be no property rights in native reserves. There will be no industry in native reserves. There will be only subsistence agriculture in native reserves. And any produce produced in those native reserves will not be sold on the open commercial market." We have a version of that here. The Mays Act of 1937, those of you older than me might remember. And what is the consequence of this? And of course, after that, being denied property rights, industry, no form of formal employment, they had to pay hard tax. So in order to pay tax, where will they get the money? They'll have to go and work in white farmers' lands, in the mines. So that was the design Cecil Rhodes erected in South Africa, and he brought it up here. Now we're very proud to say, communal lands are our culture, since when? The second thing that flows from that is this issue of rural-urban migration, as you pointed around, I've said. Because of this division of land into communal land, which is not precious, we have developed two types of water development. Industrial water development, lakes were all the big dams to serve irrigation and agricultural industry. Okay? In the communal lands, we develop drinking water, a borani that saves about 2 kilometer radius. And my grandmother goes to the borani, takes 20 liters of water, leaves the rest of the water sitting there, doing nothing. See the point now? And therefore, I saw a cartoon once of two guys in a bar, one with a castle bottle in front of it, and the other one with a half bottle of coke, and it came from the same village. Eventually, the guy with a lot of beer says, "Shemot, no, where do you work to get money to buy all those beer?" He said, "Ah, but I got a bottle of champagne, and I got a bottle of coke, and I said, I didn't come to Harare to look for work, I looked for money." Now, if that guy could have had money, he would have bothered to come to Harare, but no. There's no. So, and then, as a result of this land issue, people are migrating into urban areas. But remember, even though we don't work with type of deeds by reserve and so forth, nevertheless, this Akudepa Makatsa, isn't it? And my stature in society is judged by what they can see there. So when I come into the city, I'm not just looking for a roof over my head, I'm looking for a stand. And that explains our urban sprawl. We translate, a certain where I can build something and I can show my neighbors. Yesterday, we were in a flat. A four-bedroom flat, and the four-bedroom flat is just as empty as any other house. It did not have any land, but there were no where a visitor passing by and said, Mama Gaza. There's no sound, that identity is not there. And yet, it's a very, very good accommodation. So, if you look at the building that caught fire in Dubai, so that was a residential. Accommodation. Was it about 30 something floors? That's where people live. And the amount of land that it occupied probably was about maybe twice the size of this picture. That's all. Now, I have a friend in Malta, and he financed himself, sent his children to school, bought clothes and food by growing vegetables on his Marlborough stand. That can Kenya, it was horrendous. Fights hitting each other for land. How much land were there each fighting for? Hardly a hectare, mostly half a hectare. In Ethiopia, in the Ethiopia Highland, where they produce a lot of coffee, and it's one of the major exports of Kenya, the average land holding is a quarter of a hectare. Here, on average, we have 3-4 hectares, which we only scratch once a year in trying to grow something on. And yet, if you provide water and allow investment, people can survive on much, much smaller pieces of land than the 3-4 hectares. So that is my sort of overarching issue. The land Kenya issue, the communal land, we must address so that it allows investment in the communal land. Now, come to wetlands, carbon dioxide sequestration. The problem with our wetlands is this. We only recently adopted the word wetlands. Dagmatabo or Flays or whatever. And there are nothing like the Okavango Delta, which is vast. The Kafue floodplain, you know, or the Everglades and so forth. We have nothing that big. Our wetlands hardly could, you know, say maybe 5-10 hectares. So they look small and insignificant. Yet, all our rivers in southern Africa arise from that kind of source. This is amazing. Partly from Chile, which comes from Lake Malawi. All our big rivers arise from wetlands. And we're sitting here in Harare on those wetlands that supply the Chivas water. So it's this size concept that just bled us. Even though Romans are when they came here, they expect to find some big wetlands. Well, there are a few. So the problem is that with developers, okay, these wetlands are small. But for a developer to have a hectare, 10 hectares of land, money, fill it up with houses. After all, trees and frogs, what do they give us? So it's the size of our wetlands. But if we can consolidate them into a mosaic, mosaic of wetlands, then we are talking about carbon markets. I try to price Boroughville wetlands, Mondaville wetlands, and Driefontein. Those would be worth about $170,000 a year. What could we do with $100,000 in this rural areas? Build a couple of schools and so on. So, I guess the question about going down there, city of Harare is still here. I was informed that the city of Harare said no. So you can ask them. You see, I've been working for this university now for nearly 42 years. I have no pension, and therefore I need my annual contract to the university. You see what I mean? Yeah. The cultivation in wetlands, well, I've answered that. That, as far as cultivation is concerned, a family can make business on a much smaller piece of land. As long as somebody can invest on that, you know, I can put on my solar powered bore on my stand, do as much agriculture as I can. As far as cattle, I can say for example, grasslands, our research station, produced, did some research on pastures years ago in the 60s. And they showed that if you mix a leg called serratro in the ordinary so-called centrifuge pasture, 1 year you plant it at the beginning of the rainy season. After that, you forget it. If you go to Emire Ranch on the way to fortified with sriracha. The carrying capacity of the lake is much, much higher. Without any fortification, the holding capacity of lake about, it was about 4 hectares per beast. With this system, we have getting 2 beasts per hectare. So, rather than get the locals chiring the mob into the horsemen, lifting them in the allow, give this household, say, an extra hectare and a half. First, watered with sriracha, he can then keep his mob on his property, not umakuru. You see what I mean? So you can concentrate, you can upgrade the land use in communal lands as long as the holder can invest. I don't care what time of tenure you call it. Some politicians get very, very agitated when you suggest, say, tenure. So give you, I'll be asking, what you talk about? Title gives you much, when is there? I don't know whether anybody knows a chap called John Robertson of Greenland Economist. He was asked by Ian Smith, look, this was a problem of urban draft started there. What shall we do to stop these Africans from coming into town? He said, very simple. Give them title deeds. Smith immediately said, no. And he had a good reason. You remember it was a qualified franchise. In order to be allowed to vote, which is a racial discrimination, it was just qualified franchise. You had to be a judge, headmaster of a senior police officer, or a very successful business to be able to vote. And one of those is owning property was another item. You know, if you own the property, you could vote. So if those Africans in communal lands were given title deeds, they automatically voted. Voters wrong. And guess what happened to the government? Look, they voted out.
Maybe 2 burning questions. There's 1 there. Any other burning question? There's 1 in there. So can you pass on the microphone?
We are talking once again. Maybe the person that I asked, which I referred to the floor, is still hanging. And maybe I'll ask Dr. Chopai to ask the question from the president of the council.
Thank you very much. I have a question on the wetlands. My apologies, I had to go out when discussions were happening. What we note as the planners in the local authorities is that we have land that is zoned for certain uses in urban areas. And by virtue of zoning, the land then has value. If it is zoned commercial, then it has a commercial value, residential, recreational, and the same. And we now see a situation where that land is being termed a wetland. And I want to say it's being termed a wetland because there is no research that has been done to determine whether or not it is a wetland. Actually, in Zimbabwe, we do not have any standards yet that have been set to say this is a wetland or this is not a wetland. As a result, we have land that is zoned commercial. To me, to the person who owns the land, they have a commercial value of that land. But now this land is being termed a wetland, and that implies no development, that implies zero value as far as the person is concerned. And how do we balance that now? to say this person who has this land which has to be termed wetland versus the value that they have on the land. Is there any compensation that is there for the person who owns such a piece of land? And as local authorities also, we see a gap in the in research in determining land that we can call wetlands, because there is no standard that has been set. The map that was displayed by Professor Makata is a land which was done by EMA, picking from the land use plans that are done for Harare, but it is not based on any research. And the owners of land have not been consulted to say your piece of land is going to be designated a wetland. And naturally, they want to develop their land. So how do we balance that? And I think that is a question which begs answers, especially from the researchers from our point of view. And then going to Dr. Chapunduka's presentation, I think in a lot of the things that and the issues that he was raising, I could see that that talking that we were talking about between the academics and the practitioners is lacking, because some of the things that they perceive to be happening in local authorities are actually not happening that way. The developments that are happening there, maybe the academics are not aware of them, and probably there is need for us to be talking more so that you know where we are in terms of our urban planning structures, the GIS systems that we are setting up, so that you can also input and help us to develop them in a more comprehensive and in a useful manner. Thank you very much.
The law is quite specific. A, B, C, D cannot be done on a
on the wetland. So people who bought land, bought on a wetland, bought it knowing that there are certain developments that can take place on wetland. Same thing with me as my sister. The AMA tried to gazette pieces of land, not in the map I showed you, as wetlands. The developer challenged it. They failed on a matter of technicality of the wetland. It did not change the status that those are not wetlands. I remember one developer said, problem is that there are no more wetlands in Zimbabwe. There's no more wetlands because the law says there's no wetlands. Is that what the law says? You know? And with the question, I think Emma are regazetting those wetlands with the proper legal language to protect them. So, as I say, wetlands are recognized in law, and developments that can and cannot be happen on it are listed out in the law there.
Still on wetlands and Exonic, there was a mention of the case where a wetland may have been zoned by the local planning authority for commercial or other land use. There is a planning principle which you alluded to actually, whereby where a local planning authority is zoned land in such a manner, then it has got the responsibility to compensate the owner of the land for the impact that the zoning has had on the value of the land. And this goes on again to include procedures like transferable development rights, whereby the owner of the property can actually have the development rights transferred by the local authority to another piece of land within the municipal area. So yes, there is a scope in planning law for dealing with these issues, but the problem is that some of the principles may not be embedded in our own Zimbabwean planning law. That's where the difference may be. And then the second comment was on communication, that it may be that we as academics may not be fully aware about developments that are going on within planning in local authorities. The comment is accepted, and I think that is part of the objective of what we are trying to work on through this discussion that we are having, to set up structures, systems, and processes whereby we can remain in continuous dialogue and collaboration for the benefit of the urban citizens. So that comment is taken, but communication is two-way or multi-way. I have to highlight this because I think amongst us here and outside, we have got a lot of our professionals who are available to move the country forward, because it's suddenly like when you get to Botswana and come across a system in an urban council that is functioning very efficiently and very good, and you try to know more about it, and then they say it was developed by a Zimbabwean. I go to the University of Cape Town trying to figure out how certain systems, processes operate, and the people who are using the system cannot explain. And when you come back the third time, they give you the name of the person who developed the system, and it's a Zimbabwean. I come back home to Zimbabwe, I go to my own local authorities, I find those systems are not good, but we are busy developing systems in other countries. Thank you.
Thank you. I think on my part as session chair, we've come to. You have a very valid question?
And answer to this question.
I didn't get the question again.
Good.
The question was on the.
Thank you. My question was on the uptake of surveying the surveyors by the Cape of Customs. As far as I know, it's only Harare, Tare, and the population of the surveyors that are employed. So I wanted to find out where is the problem, because the rest of Zimbabwe and the city of the city are producing graduates in tens. Where are we going
to go? Thank you. I think we need someone from or others from the Urban Council. Want to respond to that?
Thank you very much. I think the answer is very simple. That she has already partially answered it to say you are running in flower, just a matter of scope. It's a specialist area. If somebody goes to Vund and is a laser there, what would they be doing for the on a day-to-day basis? So I think it's an issue of producing products that do not match the consumer. We would rather have a town planner whom surveyor so that the person is fully engaged. The real issue is those people cannot be engaged as a land surveyor in any of our regional authorities, probably just two or three. But for the rest of them, definitely it is not, it's not wise, it's not cost-effective. So we need multi-skilling because of the size of our local authorities. In the end, we'll have to employ a lot more people. Think of when we have our waterways, how many people would be employing if we're taking specialists by specialists by specialists by specialists. It will be very difficult because a lot of processes go there that need specialists. But we then have our generalists who then produce the water that you like so much.
There's a big issue which is at hand, which needs to be looked at. The land surveyors, the surveyor is required the local authority, the surveyor who is registered. So the graduate, the land surveyor, yes, there is graduate, is knowledgeable land survey matters, but you cannot do a kind of survey which can be submitted to the surveyor general's office and be approved. Maybe it's got to go via the next land surveyor who's going to sign his or her papers. Then the survey can be approved by the survey general's office. So that is where the issue is. If maybe the council of land surveyors can maybe shorten the time frame of the training of the graduate land surveyor so that they can quickly go into practice, register and maybe to. At the present moment, it won't make sense if I have the option to get the registered land surveyor, come and do my title surveys, and I have my plans approved quickly. It won't make sense for me to get a graduate who then try to look around for a registered land surveyor to get the survey approved. Thank you.
Now the surveyors